Greetings, this is Vlodril and welcome back to Let's Play Tyranny. Alrighty, we just killed the voice of Narat, got his weapon, I gave it to him. This is pretty good, but I have artifacts, so I don't want to use those. Some crap. Actually, one of them was good. Cool.
Right.
Is there anything else around here? I don't think so, but... just crap, okay. I guess we're good to go. Why are these guys hostile anymore? What is just standing there?
That.
Most of the chorus has gone already. It didn't take long to see who was going to be on top. Okay. So what happens with those guys? I don't know. I can't talk to anybody here. Maybe if I had Verse with me, it would be different. But again, another playthrough. And back to. Actually, we'll go there. Rest. And then we'll go to Grevenas, which is the last of the Archons. Apart from us, Tunon has already bent the knee. I definitely think that the voice of Narat was a more interesting character than Grevenas. Do they say anything about
what
happened?
Good day, Fatebinder. What do you need?
No. Again, I'm leaving here for the next playthrough. The next playthrough, I'll totally change my party. I'll have Verse, Siren, and
I got it.
Maybe the Beast Woman.
What do you need?
Nothing new. Fair enough. Moving on. What do we got? Oh, the artifact. The final scream. I will finish the game and I won't have unlocked the last tier because, again, maybe I missed something. I don't know what the major, very major thing. After all the things that happened, I don't know what the hell else would I do. Alright. I won't cast an edict on the Iron Hearth and we'll see how it goes. We'll probably have to fight, let's face it. I don't see Grevenas bowing out. I wonder what will happen with Barak. We'll find out soon. I'm not sure if it's wise to bring him or I should switch to someone else, but we'll see. Yeah, this definitely looks like a fight.
I see no fresh blood on your armor, but I sense that something has happened. Where once many congregated, there is now an absence. That can mean only one thing. The voices of Narat is no more. Can this be true?
Before he can go on, Ash's shoulders tremble, and he clutches one arm to repress the shaking. He squeezes his eyes shut, only opening them again once his composure is restored. I have destroyed the Argon of Secrets.
At last, the Scarlet Chorus are undone. We can properly conduct this war and subjugate the Tears as Kairos intended. That I can see this day, while the voices of Narat grows cold. He would never forget this indignity.
How do you plan to do that?
Considering how much you've managed to subdue the disorder of the Tears, finalizing our conquest in Kairos' name should be little more than tidying up pockets of discontent. We could have the entire realm subdued under the laws and customs we hold dear within the next span.
We still have to settle the matter of Kairos' decree. Only one Archon may rule the Tears.
Yes. I thought we would come to this. I had hoped to avoid the confrontation. Your service to my army has been exemplary, and I hate to lose a friend on the eve of victory. I knew you as Tunon's pupil, but now you are an Archon, and so much more. I would see you continue in your service to Kairos, but as my ally rather than my enemy. Bow in allegiance to me, and Kairos will be appeased. We can govern this lawless land together, and invite the savages into civilized custom.
I think the other way is how it should be. This doesn't make any sense. This doesn't make any sense. So,
I was
the first one.
This would be your temperament, and it saddens me. Power should have humbled you, but it has made you vain. What do you propose then? Will we fight to the death needlessly, or will you reconsider my offer?
There is another way. You can bow to me.
A proposal as insulting as it is laughable. You are an Archon in your infancy, unproven, untested, and unprepared for the trials of leadership.
Submit. I have proven myself the true general, and your army is mine to command. Disfavored, favored for. Yours? But what possible right? By what mad ambition do you challenge my... The strength behind his words falters, and Ash goes silent. His brow creases, and the severity of his expression diminishes as he looks to the soldiers around you. The countrymen he proudly marched into war. He studies them each in turn, nodding as some unspoken truth is confirmed.
I am not ignorant to the wisdom of your words. They pierce me like a lance through my heart, but there is truth. This conquest has opened old wounds. At times, I have not acted like the leader that my army deserved. I was an accomplished warlord in the earliest days of the Empire. There was no fortress I couldn't breach. No distance I couldn't march. But the years have reduced me. I care too deeply for my legion to see them suffer. I lost nearly everyone for whom I cared, and suffered for those I sought to protect. I would not wish this for anyone. I submit to your authority as Archon and Master of the Disfavored. Where you lead, I go. Where you command, I follow.
A wise choice. The disfavored will see their honor restored under my rule. Yeah. Fatebinder, you have proven yourself a true general than I ever was. A truer general. I relinquish my hold over these women and men and place them in your keeping. I ask only that you be good to them. They are far from home and deserve treatment and leadership befitting their noble blood. I submit to you. As your archon, I will obey your laws, carry out your orders, and protect whoever, whatever way of life you see fit to impose on the tears. And beyond. Awesome. You carry a heavy burden now. It is no small task to lead a legion. Their lives and their deaths are yours to bear. At times, the strain was too much, even for the likes of me. Devotion claims a heavy toll, and over the years it wore me down, until he trails off, focusing on some point in the distance. Are you right? Fine, fine. Ignore an old man's wandering mind. You are young yet, with the world laid out before you. Your soldiers will look to you for guidance. You must be ready to take on any challenge on their behalf. Lead by example. Lead with the iron fist of the disfavored. Cool. I like how the music swells at the appropriate moment. The time has come to bring glory and triumph to this conquest. Go now, and bring order to what remains of the tears. I will stay behind with the army, training and preparing to carry out your will. I can hardly believe it. You are the great general now. I will adore us to my dying day, but I never expect to see him bend the knee. I received word before you arrived. Though the other Archons are vanquished, Kairos sent another army to march on the tears. They make for the mountain spire and chant for your blood. It seems that the Overlord will not tolerate competition. What are your orders? What would you recommend? Nothing less than a demonstration of power will halt the Overlord's advance. I suggest you find the means of flaunting your authority that will send a clear message. An edict on the Northern Empire should do the trick. Upon the North itself, I like this idea not at all, but I cannot deny it is the right course of action. Do whatever you must to repel this advance. Go now, to Vendrian's will. Nice. Your power has increased, but no level ups. Awesome.
I got it.
That goes cool. And now, I guess we have to deal with Kairos. Again, I would have loved if the game let me be loyal to Kairos and stay just as a ruler of the tears, but absolute power and all. Not corrupt, but I guess he can't risk me being able to amass more power. Vendrian's will. This game is very good. Obsidian did a great job on progressing from Pillars of Eternity. They still need to take care of some issues that I have, that we will discuss by the end of the game, but they did an amazing job with the game. The waves of energy radiating from the spire draw you forward, pressing your body and mind to its eager embrace. As the center of this tide, the resonator stands ready to broadcast your voice. This probably amounts to declaration of war against the Overlord. Ready? I knew we'd make our stand at Vendrin's Well. I just imagine we'll all die miserable. Who would have predicted the Archon of the Tears would save us? I can feel it's coaxing like breeze, not since Grevenas stood against Kairos. Following your progress has been, well, one of the greatest pleasures of my career. You have shown yourself something greater than I ever expected. Yes, let's do this. Where are the Northern Legions? Oh, there it is, Northern Empire. Storms or stones? Minus 15 to all magic skills, no. Yep. This is my go-to edict. The effects are great too, much better than Pillars of Eternity. Legion of Victory. Casting the Edict of Storms wreaks havoc on the northern capital. The winds whip in a sudden frenzy and toss unsuspecting citizens through the air, dashing them back down in the rubble of leveled buildings. Temporary settlements take on refugees fleeing the devastation from the now uninhabitable city. Survivors ask the same question. Why did the Overlord allow this to happen? As chaos ensued in the Northern Kingdom, the armies marching on the Tears received an unprecedented order. The armies were to fall back to the capital and ensure the safety of its people from the edict. For the first time in Kairos' great conquest, the armies retreat. Soon questions would be asked in a hushed breath across the lands about what new and terrible power had emerged that could force the hand of the Overlord. You fulfilled Kairos' decree, and all the Tears is now ruled by a single Archon. Your former rivals have either submitted to you or perished, bringing the civil war to a close. The Scarlet Chorus may have been mighty in numbers, this should have been voiced by the way, but that didn't stop you from sterilely scattering them, cutting off the Serpent's head and sending each of the gangs howling back to the chaos they sowed. How the remnants of the Horde occupy themselves without a war to fight becomes a topic of nightmares. It was thought that his favorite would never rally under another general, but by enlisting Grevenas to your cause, you managed the next best thing, controlling the Archon to harness the strength of the Northern Empire. You reorganized their old-fashioned regiment with a new chain of command. I should have given them their name back, by the way, instead of still calling them disfavored. The Legion victory spread beyond count, and your soldiers trained hard, preparing for the retaliation to come. Under your guidance, those who resisted the conquest and sowed discontent are vanquished. The rebellion brought to a decisive end. Any lingering question of who is the true ruler of the Tears is answered by your impact on the reconstructed nation. Word of your success spreads beyond the Tears as well. Even the most distant corners of the Empire whispers of the Fatebinder who rose to become an Archon, and an Archon whose intervention shattered the conquest, making way for a new future in the devastated nation. Uniting the Tears under the banner of the Disfavored was never your directive, and yet you performed it admirably, consolidating the Overlord's forces under your rule and grooming the Tears for their place in a new order. The same people who once held curses across a siege soon learned to think of themselves as part of a greater whole, extending beyond their modest borders. With the Edict of Stone dispelled, the earth around the Stone Sea finally settles, leading everyone to believe the realm of Azur will return to its former glory. but the ritual used when they edict blighted the land to such a degree that nothing will grow, no matter how hard anyone tries. With determination, some are able to start a small seedling, but nothing ever comes of it. So this is where we get our choices, I guess. Read back to us and see what the consequences was. The memory of Cairn as a great force of destruction remains as a monument of inert rock. Most agree that the world is better off without the Archon of Stone, as the people of Azur begin to slowly reclaim the land that was once torn asunder by his power. As the strongest and oldest of their kind, the death of the Stone Stalkers is a blow to the Beastman culture. The demise also brings centuries of oral tradition to an abrupt end. The local tribes never recover from a terrible loss. With Cairn's essence preserved and the lands of Azur permanently blighted, the Earthshakers return to the disfavored. While their reputation isn't what it used to be, their success in dealing such a decisive blow to the Scarlet Chorus by removing the main source of food has earned back the respect of the Legion. The Earthshakers are accepted back into the ranks, once again becoming part of the army. With the Unbroken all but destroyed, the former citizens of Stalwart threaten to slide into lawlessness. Karos' forces stationed at the Sentinel Sand managed to quell the worst of the uprising, but peace under the nation's new leadership is resisted at every turn. You put the last of Grenvern's ass family to the sword, ensuring that the end of his long and decorated lineage. Yeah, that was really dark. Though you often wonder if more could have been done to prevent that horrible deed, you don't bother yourself wondering for long. Though it takes time to recover from the devastation of the Edict of Storms, the Blade Grave begins its slow march toward the healing. The realm of Stalwart may never resemble its former glory, but the land is not so blasted that something new and better can't be built. The region's bloodline has ended. With it, new traditions and legacies spring up to life. Your travels never took you to the Burning Library. Thanks, game. Thanks. I know. Good job. And this leaves the Edict of Fire undisturbed. Yeah, I fucked that up pretty badly. With their arcane knowledge beyond reach, the School of Ink and Quill falls into a steep decline, your name becoming a curse in their embittered ranks. I'm definitely doing the independent run. By leaving Lithian's Crossing under disfavored command, you are soon the city's cooperation and productiveness, blah blah blah. After the war, people speak of it as forged days, when the city was a lump of unformed metal waiting to be formed. By returning the Mage Bane Helm to the Lithian's Crossing, you ensure the Bane will not be able to get into the city. The threat is disabled, the settlers are grateful. Protection of iron remains where it belongs, safe in northern hands. By enacting an edict of Fendrian's Will, you announced your power to the world and showed Kairos' forces what you were capable of. When you defeated their leader and scattered the army before you, it sent the message to Kairos: a new Archon is born. Well, the edict dissipated, its effect will always be felt as the first true threat to Kairos' rule. Oh my god, so much reading. Grevenas continues to lead. At first, the great general balks at your instructions, but in time, he grows to trust your judgment without question. Working together, you bring much needed order to the lawless tears. Killing the voice of Nerad spreads the joy of bloody vengeance across the continent. Celebrated as the death of history's greatest parasite, the occasion is marked by all who suffered under the opposition of the Scarlet Chorus. Even in victory, one thought nags you. My throat will die. Though you witness his death, you can't help but wonder if the voices is done with you. Too known, the Adjudicator continues to dispense justice from his seat in the Bastard City. He follows the laws you craft to the letter, advising on any of the meticulous changes you lack the time or the patience to draft. The death of Bladenmark deprived the world of a most capable murderer, One less bedtime story to scare Childer. It's no significant loss, though you can't help but glance at the dark corners of every room and feel as if something is watching you. Blood and Mark will always cast a long shadow on your life. That guy was cool. Barrick positions himself as among the rank and file of your supporters, organizing troops around the strengths, blah blah blah. His armor clings to him. He never actually let me do anything about that, which is weird. Life is good for the tiring soldier. Vers founds herself adrift in the relative peace. She returns to the field and seeks out the young women from rural communities, imparting her fighting skills to only the most passionate. She follows the voice of Nerat example and forms a personal army, the Kalus Sisterhood. Okay. Landry keeps a close watch over you. Chronicle with history and knowledge, he follows you even in his twilight years. And together you learn much about the world. You pretend not to notice Landry's waning strength, though you find yourself pausing mid-sentence to let him writing catch up. He recognizes your generous ruse and appreciates its silence. Every man is in your company, okay. She takes on a team of apprentices, a new school of would-be tidecasters. She left, clearing shadow, which I don't care. She discovers a haggard community of beastmen who abandoned the realms of Haven and Azure only to be enslaved by Karos forces. She forges the tribes, the raid villages and caravans, blah blah blah. Seren grows quiet over time, speaking little and forgoing her songs. As it distances yourself away, we didn't do anything with her, so. You leave her in peace. Though you once preferred loyalty to Kairos, popular belief holds that the world cannot support two overlords, and you now represent a threat to the established order. This leaves your future in question. With what but one certainty, when Kairos retaliates, you will be ready. Okay, and that's it. That was kinda a poor ending. Alright. So, that ends Tyranny. Alright, final thoughts. This is a pretty good game. Again, I want to thank Obsidian for sending me a key for it. I thoroughly enjoyed it. And it's much, much bigger in scope than I thought. On that note, it is obvious that the last act was not what it should have been. I'm not sure if they ran out of time or money, but it definitely could have expanded to be a lot more, gave a lot more information, come to a more satisfying conclusion, and have perhaps someone doing the view over the choices would be nice. As far as the game itself goes, it's an improvement on story, somewhat, on gameplay for sure, on the engine also for sure. The magic was amazing, the soundtrack was great. I think it is a vast improvement from Pillars of Eternity in everything but characters. I felt the characters were lacking, if you compare them, your companions at least, with characters like the Grieving Mother and the Durant from Pillars of Eternity. I think they should place more focus on their next game, on their characters, because it was always one of the things that elevated their games for me, at least, from other companies. Anyway, this is a fantastic game, let's face it. I definitely recommend you play it if you like isometric role-playing games. I will be there for whatever next game they decide to produce. And it took me, what, 40 hours? So not 15 hours at all. Pretty happy with that. And you can... wow, nice. This was unexpected too, they didn't actually make a Kickstarter for it, you just, you know, just released it. I wish they spent more time on the third act, but again, I would put this on 2 on my personal GOTY list. That was Tyranny, thank you for watching this series if you managed to come this far. Subscribe, like, leave a comment, you know it, by heart by now I guess, and I will see you in the next series.